Here in the US, a good 40% of all the energy we use goes into buildings. Like, not the construction of buildings, just the existence of buildings. Sitting there with their lights on and their appliances humming and their climate-controlled air. And if we want to have any hope of dialing back our energy usage, we have to rethink our buildings. The good news is we are. Many new buildings have special windows meant to keep things cool by letting some light in and blocking the rest. But we are just starting to learn how certain wavelengths in sunlight, even invisible ones, can be really important for our health. They can help with conditions ranging from nearsightedness to COVID to Alzheimer's. This is terrible news for me as a person who loves to just work in the dark all of the time. And this begs the question, are energy efficient windows bad for us? Energy-efficient windows are basically like sunglasses for buildings. They filter out some of the sun's rays and make things more comfortable on the other side. One way to do this is with a low emissivity coating, or a low E coating. This coating mainly reflects infrared waves, which carry heat. It keeps outside heat from coming in during the summer and indoor heat from escaping during the winter. Low E coatings also filter out almost all of the sun's UV light. That doesn't help much with keeping things cool, but it does help protect furniture and decorations from fading. Low E materials are great for saving energy and protecting indoor environments, but these savings come with some downsides for the people behind the glass. Almost every cell in our bodies follows a circadian rhythm that aligns with the 24-hour cycle of day and night. And it's not just responsible for the jet lag we get after an overseas flight. Circadian rhythms also control our sleep patterns, appetites, hormones, and a bunch of other biological functions. So it's really important for all of these cellular clocks to stay synced up. Our cells take their main cue from the sun, syncing up with the 24-hour pattern of light and dark here on Earth. They respond especially strongly to blue light, which activates special pigments in our eyes. The problem is that the same film that blocks UV and infrared light also filter out a good amount of blue and violet light. So if you're sitting behind some of this fancy glass all day, you might not be getting all the cues you need to tune your circadian rhythm, and that could be a problem. Disrupted circadian rhythms have been linked with higher rates of heart disease, diabetes, and obesity. They also may be behind an uptick in nearsightedness, or myopia. Nearly a third of all people are now nearsighted, and myopia is becoming more common all around the world. And there's a reason researchers suspect this could have something to do with our windows. One study found that rates of myopia are lower in rural areas where people spend more time outside compared to urban areas. Another study found that when mice were exposed to violet light in the lab, they had lower rates of myopia than mice exposed to regular fluorescent lights or other wavelengths. But as for why this is, researchers aren't sure yet. What we do know is that in the retina, special pigments called neuropsins get activated by violet light, and that helps the circadian rhythm of these cells, which controls how they function. In nearsighted people, one layer of cells in the retina, called the choroid, tends to be thinner than normal. So it's possible that our scrambled circadian rhythms are messing with the development of the choroid, making so many of us nearsighted. The way that we're going, the World Health Organization predicts that half of all people will be nearsighted by 2050. At the same time, we may be missing out on important benefits from the other end of the spectrum, because infrared light can also be good for our health. One thing it can do is help our bodies reduce inflammation. While inflammation is part of our body's natural healing process, too much of it can cause serious damage. For example, most COVID deaths are not caused by the virus itself, but by severe inflammation, which creates respiratory problems and other issues. So in cases like this, reducing inflammation can be life-saving, and infrared light therapy has already been helpful in treating severe COVID and other conditions caused by severe inflammation. The weird thing is, the treatment was discovered by accident, and we are not sure exactly how it works. We know that short wavelengths of infrared light, known as near-infrared, interact with specific enzymes inside our cells, triggering some chain reactions. Some of these reactions kick up energy production in our cells, and that boost of energy could help our cells protect themselves and repair damage. These interactions also produced bursts of reactive oxygen species, unstable molecules that can interact easily with other molecules. Reactive oxygen species are mostly known for just wreaking havoc in the body, but they also play an important role in interacting with the molecules that regulate our immune response, so triggering these bursts may help keep inflammation from getting out of hand. These chain reactions kicked off by infrared light may also help protect against neurodegenerative disease. Experiments in mice and rats with traumatic brain injuries have also shown that near-infrared light triggers the growth of new brain cells and new connections between cells. It's not clear yet how true this is for humans, things, but it's at least a hint that our windows may be depriving us of some real benefits of infrared light. Not in my case, though, because I don't have windows in my office. So what do we do about the fact that so many of us are stuck inside for most of the day behind windows that filter out a bunch of natural daylight? Some people have argued that we need to scrap windows with low-E coatings. The problem is, they do a lot of good. One federal report found that they can cut buildings' HVAC costs by almost a third, so getting rid of them isn't a great answer. And so far, we don't have any great answers, but that's not to say there's nothing we can do. Some people have tried using artificial lights to mimic natural daylight cycles and help sync our body clocks. And these days, there are modern windows that essentially work like transition lenses, adjusting their filters in real time. Could those be tweaked to let in more daylight at certain times of the day, like mornings and evenings when the sun isn't so hot? Or going forward, maybe we could design buildings that are more naturally suited to their environments. Instead of filling city centers with boxy glass buildings that need constant climate control, we could take some lessons from older local architecture, which at least has windows you can open to let a breeze in. I'm not saying this is easy. Engineering solutions for our modern lives will be complicated, especially when it comes to managing something like the sun's radiation, which does both harm and good. So it's going to take some real creativity, but in the meantime, we should do our best to get outside and soak up some unfiltered daylight whenever we can. That's the real answer for me, and I hope I can do it. This video was inspired by The Inner Clock, a new book by Lynn Peoples. It's all about circadian rhythms and the surprising number of ways they affect our lives. I really enjoyed it. If you'd like to check it out, head to the SciShow Bookshop page. It's a thing that we have now. That's exciting for me. This video was made possible by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation.